I'm Steve Dotto. Welcome everybody into the room. Our webinar here will be starting in just a few moments. I just have to welcome you all and introduce you to our cast of characters, and then I'll pass things over. It's kind of dueling hosts here. I'm Steve Dotto, and I'm going to be taking you through most of the content today. But Greg Smith from Thinkific is actually the host. This is Greg's community here that he's welcoming in. So I'll get Greg to say hello to you, and I'm also going to introduce you to Jen Butler, who Jen works with me, and she's going to be making sure that all of the back end stuff here moves smoothly. That doesn't sound quite right, does it? But we're going to make sure that everything in the webinar moves smoothly if we have any technical issues, which we could well have today, as the internet gremlins have been attacking us just pre-getting online with you. Let's just get Greg in to say hello, and then I'll fill everybody in on the structure and what's happening. Greg, how are you doing today?
I'm great, and really excited to have you here, and welcome to everyone who is here and hanging out with us. I see people popping in and saying hi already. That's great. Yeah, really excited to have Steve here. Steve and I are friends from Vancouver, actually. So we are friends in real life, not just online friends. And he's, you know, I've watched his YouTube channel, but even TV show back in the day. And so really, I hear from a lot of people in our Thinkific audience. I hear from people here attending that they have questions about creating content, about if I want to do an online course, usually that first sticking point is how am I going to put my videos together or my lessons together. And so I couldn't think of anyone better to bring in to help you with that kind of thing than Steve. And I look to him when I'm trying to figure out how to do stuff better. I ask him questions all the time about should I do my editing or content creation. I hop on webinars and he'll tell me, oh, you should be doing it this way or you should add that in. So he's a great guy to go to for advice, and has a really good background and understanding in this space. And he lives and breathes it every day with his YouTube channel and his courses and creating all of that stuff. So he was the best person I could possibly find to bring here to you to help you with this side of things. And as a bonus, he is entertaining. Not to put any pressure on you, Steve, there, to be entertaining, but he's an entertaining guy. I love watching his videos. I can binge watch his YouTube channel, which says a lot, because I don't have a lot of time for that kind of thing. So I think it'll be a lot of fun. I think you're going to learn a lot from Steve. And Steve, I'll let you take it away. Thanks so much for sharing this with everyone here.
Well, Greg, thanks so much for introducing me to your community. I know we did a webinar to my community with Thinkific a couple of weeks ago, and in it, everybody that was involved thanked you guys. Thank me so much for introducing me to your product, because it's a tool that is making their businesses run more smoothly and their lives better. Just a quick overview of what's happening today and what to expect. So we're using basically Google Hangouts on Air to deliver this webinar using a tool called Webinar Jam, which is a wrapper over top, which facilitates things like the chat, which you are already using and introducing yourself ever so well in. If you do have issues, if we do have some sort of a connection issue or anything happens or life gets in the way, fear not. As soon as this webinar is over, there will be a complete webinar replay sent out to you. It takes about an hour for it to get all encoded and sent out. But the cool thing about the webinar replay is it includes the chat, which is important because the chat in my webinars ends up being a very valuable additional bit of knowledge and content. Because how I structure my webinars is I do something called hybrid webinars. I'm going to do a little bit of a slideshow, filling you in a little bit on the back and what on my background and what to expect, and talk a little bit about screencasting and online video for courses. But then I'm going to actually show you the process that I go through when I create my videos for my courses and for my YouTube channel. And in order to do that, yesterday I actually recorded a screencast to use. It works far better in a webinar format, playing back a video for this sort of thing, because you'll get clear screens. If I try and demo to you on the screen here live in screen share, the screens are fuzzy and nobody can see any detail. So I've recorded actually about a 30-minute video, but we take advantage of that time and we jump into chat and answer your questions and kind of move the ball downfield as it's going. So this isn't one of those faux webinars where we pretend to be live but we're not live. We're really live, There will be a video insert, and it's up just about 30 minutes. But it's quite a detailed demo. And anybody who's interested in becoming better or starting out creating videos for their courses, I go through all of the different important touch points as we go along. So I see it's great that you guys are already jumping into chat. So what I'm just going to start out with a little bit of a slideshow filling you in on who I am, because most of you, I imagine, I am new to, because I doubt many of you grew up in Canada where my TV show made me a B-list celebrity. Here we go. Well, I was. It's not okay. I got to get both Jen and Greg to mute their mics and stuff so that we don't have.
I'm gonna mute. I'm blinking twice. Someone asked us to blink twice.
That's what I just said too. I said, Joel, I blinked twice. Did you see it?
Okay, just a minute. Now you've got me all messed up. Look at this mess that we have here. Where is there's?
I'm turning my camera and voice off. So
you're quiet, everybody. Mute your mics. Not you. People who are online and watching, who I like. It's just my co-hosts now that I'm having an issue with. All right. So is everybody? I hope you're getting my the feed of my screen now. Screencasting for course design with me. That's Steve Dotto. So a little bit about me, as I said. I'm going to go through my hardware and software, my screencasting setup, because I believe, especially the audio side, it's so important to have gear that you're comfortable with and that delivers the quality that you're looking for. And then we're going to dive into the actual video screen, the value that video and screencasting has for courses, and then how I produce my product, how I produce my videos. But I want to start by talking a little bit about video itself and the reasons that video is so effective. And the bottom line is, when you're creating course content, the more senses that we can engage, the more vital and the more vibrant that content is going to be. And we have become such a video-consuming community these days. And the value of video is completely, we all understand it, we love to use it. But I think a lot of us lose track of one of the biggest touch points. One of the biggest reasons that video has become so effective for us is increasingly, now you might not notice it yet in your courses, but you will, and I have noticed it in all of my content, increasingly engagement is happening in mobile. Tablets to a certain extent, but phones, even the large format phones. That mobile connection, the fact that people are consuming our content in mobile, really ends up being detrimental to anything other than video. Text is not that great to read on a smartphone. It's okay to read snippets, but to really learn and to read is very difficult, whereas the smartphone is almost tailor-made for delivering video. Its format works perfectly. Our ADHD leanings delivers to us the fact that we're getting constant stimulation from video. So video is increasingly becoming kind of the currency for communication across all social networks and certainly we find it in our course content. So I'm just completely bullish on video. Now, a little bit about me. I actually am a little bit of a newbie to the online space, having spent about maybe 4 years, 4.5 years now working in the online world. For 20 years, I was a traditional broadcaster here in Canada. I had a television show called Dotto Tech, which was syndicated nationally. We had about 20 million viewers a year. We were a household. We were just like those of you in the United States. I'm kind of Canada's Leo Laporte. I would teach people how to use technology, although I'm much better looking than Leo. So for 20 years, I produced a weekly television show and did all the things that were related. I did a live radio show for years. I used to write a newspaper column. So I was in all the mainstream media here in Canada talking about technology and how it applies in our lives. About 5 years ago, I stopped doing the TV show. Actually, a little bit less than 5 years ago, I stopped doing the TV show. And about 3 years ago, I began to focus and rebuild my brand, but on YouTube. And since then, I've grown YouTube into the lead magnet for my business. I've done about 12 courses, and I'm completely in the content marketing space now. That's really what I do. Is my YouTube channel is my main social network, and my main payment system. The way that I make most of my money is through my delivery of courses, and of course, all of my courses are delivered on video. But here's an interesting little tidbit. We're going to be talking today about screencasting, using our computer as the basis for recording and editing all of our video. But I consider myself to be, if not a, maybe even the screencasting pioneer. This is a photo of me way back in the day, 1992, when I was doing my very first TV show, and we were we recognized at that point there, we were actually doing a TV show to teach teachers how to use computers in the classroom. And we recognized that the computer had to be a character in our show. It had to be, we couldn't just talk about things, we had to show them screens. And we had to show them screens and show them dialogue boxes and actually show them what was happening on the computer screen. But if you remember back in the day, we used to have these big-ass CRT monitors, and if you saw any video on television, you'd get that hum bar going through because of the sync, the timing difference between the studio, the broadcast system, and the computer, the refresh rate of the computer monitor. So we actually MacGyvered video cards ourselves that changed the timing of our computer monitors to sync with the studio timing so that big Ikigami camera that you see in the background there would not be getting a hum bar going through it as I was showing the screen. I don't think anybody started doing screencasting earlier than that, but it made our show exceptional. Actually, we won awards of excellence from PBS, or from the not PBS, from the U.S. public television. I can't even remember the name of it. I got the award somewhere, but for excellence in television because of the fact that we actually showed people for the first time how computers worked on the screen, teaching them real practical processes. And so from that point on, I recognized the value of showing, of making the screen, what was happening on my computer screen, equal or even more important than what I was doing on air. So I began that back in 1992. As I say, I don't know if anybody was doing it any earlier than that. But my gosh, it was a lot of work to do that. This was my crew. Or sorry, fast forward, that screen doesn't matter. This was my crew in 1992, or part of them. This was the control room that was recording the TV show. And look at the number of people that were involved to make a video that would end up on air. Basically not much more than a screencast. We had, you know, cameramen, floor directors, sound people, teleprompter. These were just the people that were involved at the beginning. By the time that the show actually went to air, I figured that somewhere between 27 and 32 people touched each of my shows in order to get it on air. There was just a tremendous amount of manpower that went into telling these narratives, to tell these little stories in video. Well, let's fast forward that to today. And today, in 2016, this is my crew. I like to say every one of those people who I actually, the only thing I miss about television is I miss being part of a team. I loved being part of that crew. And every one of those people has been sadly replaced by a USB port. But oh my gosh, I can produce video so much faster, so much more effectively, and so much more economically now than I ever could before. So with a simple Mac Pro computer, a good quality audio setup, and a little bit of lighting and a green screen and a piece of software, I can create, while not quite the same quality as my old TV show, I can create the same level of value in content as my old show. And that's really the nature of screencasting. And that's what we all strive to do, is to create good, compelling content that's sticky, that's going to have some legs, that's going to last for a period of time and serve our audience, whether it be it students or be it a, you know, an entertainment audience that we have on YouTube. So for me, when I start thinking about actually setting up any sort of a screencasting setup, I always start with audio. And I think audio is the most important factor in your video for your screencasting or for your video for your courses. And the reason is, if you stop and think about it, people will watch bad quality video that has good quality audio. They will not consume good quality video that has poor audio. Our ears are more sensitive organs than our eyes. And so it irritates us to a certain extent to have poor quality audio. I mean, I'm pretty sure right now most of you listening are going, wow, Steve's audio sounds good, because I really spend energy and put together a really good pro quality setup, which I consider to be like the most important part of creating good quality video for any online delivery. Now, I've got a really expensive setup. I've got a pro setup, but you can start with something as basic as a blue Yeti microphone, around $100 or even $60 with the Audio-Technica mics, these USB mics. They're going to create to what you would hear right now, pretty much as good a quality as you're hearing from me right now. They will create that. The key to understand when you purchase and set up any mic is pay attention to the manufacturer's details on where you should be sitting and the mic should be sitting in relationship to your mouth. they all of these microphones have a very small, let's call it the cone of influence, an area where that actually the microphone works. When you cut back to me in video, you'll see that I sit right on top of my microphone. The microphone that I use is designed for the radio studio, and it's designed for you to sit right on cross on top of and be almost uncomfortably close to. Make sure you pay attention to that, because that makes all the difference in the world. Just being 5 inches too far away from a mic will drop the quality probably by 50%. So make sure you pay attention and position the mic exactly where it is. In fact, it's more important for the mic to be positioned properly, even if it sticks into the camera shot or something like that, as far as I'm concerned, than having some beautiful shot of you where people don't realize that there's a mic there. Everybody knows you got a mic. So make sure that it's there. And some of these ones, like the Audio-Technica, the one in the bottom kind of left-hand corner, they look freaking cool on a set because they just look so pro. All right, so that's the audio setup. As far as video, I use a Mac. It doesn't matter if you use a Mac or PC, but what you need is you need a good quality video camera along with that. Typically speaking, the bezel camera that you get in your computer, you know, if you have a notebook, doesn't quite do as good a quality. Most people choose the Logitech C920, which I use. And the nice thing if you're in Windows is it's got color balancing software that's included. You always make sure that you go through, especially if you're doing any video like shooting a person's a video face, you always make sure if you color balance, the quality of video is going to look so much better. So I spend a lot of time making sure that my camera is set up right as far as tuning it, just setting up the color balance. In the Mac, there's a piece of software that we use called webcam settings that allows us to do the white balancing as well. But that gives a natural quality of video, color to my video, which you'll be seeing in a moment. We'll actually be playing a screencast video back in a moment. So the camera makes a big difference. And then, of course, is the software. I don't believe, and I'll mention this in the video, I don't believe it's worth going super cheap and trying to get away with the web-based screencasting software. This is, if you're creating video for your courses, that means that that's the heart of your courses. That's what you're selling to your students. So using good quality tools, ScreenFlow on the Mac or Camtasia in Windows, is I think it's just foolhardy to try and do it any other way, to try and take any shortcuts. So I use, as I say, ScreenFlow on the Mac, and I purchased an older Mac Pro, like a fourth generation or fifth generation Mac Pro that you can pick up on Craigslist for, you know, a couple of $1,000 or less, but it's a real workhorse. Because remember, you are doing video, so just using your notebook, even though you can get away with that, you're stretching its capabilities. The more power that horsepower that you bring to this particular rodeo, the better. And the nice thing about a tool like the computer that I'm using here, this Mac Pro, is it's very expandable, so it's very easy to add storage. Because at the end of the day, video takes up a lot of space as far as storing it all. So I think right now what we should do is I'm going to just stop this screen share right now and come back here. How are y'all doing? Is everybody still there? Greg, you can unmute.
I'm here.
Having interesting chat. Is everything going smoothly?
Yeah, good. Definitely going smoothly. I'm taking some notes here, to be honest.
You'll get the replay too. I want you to concentrate on the task at hand. Greg.
It was only one or two notes, but
this is about the people in the audience right now. Okay, so here's what we're going to do, folks. Is I'm going to dive in and I'm going to give you a bit of a demo of my video process. I'm going to show you how I record my, to a certain extent, how I record, but how I edit and package all my videos. And I recorded this as a screencast yesterday. But to give you a frame of reference, this is about a 30-minute video which we're about to play, and I will dive into chat as soon as it starts. It took me about 2 hours yesterday from start to finish to have it ready and uploaded and ready to go. It shouldn't take you an inordinate amount of time to create good quality video content once you have your systems in place, once you know your tools. And the biggest part is knowing your content, which you are already doing. You're already working on that process. So, Jen, let's fire up the video, and I will see all of you folks in chat, and we'll come back for Q&A as soon as this video part is done. Okay, it's time for us to take a look at exactly how I create my content and talk to you about the important points of each of these different techniques that we use and why it's important both for clarity and for value in our course, but also as far as efficiency for creating content efficiently. And I'm going to just pop open here ScreenFlow, which is this screencasting software that I use to create all of the video in my channel. And those of you that are in Windows, consider this to be Camtasia. They work very similarly, and the output is pretty much identical in both camps. Now, here's the key thing to understand about recording video and screencasting and using screencasting and why I'm so bullish on the concept of screencasting is the editing of the actual video is an important part of what ScreenFlow is or the screencasting software is, but what screencasting software really represents is a collection point. It is the point that all of your different digital assets that are going to go into your video appear. The strength of ScreenFlow is we can do a recording like I'm doing right now and you are seeing right now as I do this. This is a screencast that I've recorded right now. But all of the different assets that we need are brought into place, be it graphics, be it audio, be it screencasting, be it anything at all that we want to incorporate into the video is brought here. So back in the day, when I used to do my TV show and we would compose a video, we would record the video at one time and then the graphics would be composed separately and then they would be assembled in the editing suite. And all of the additional content would all be assembled post-production. The fact is, as we're recording and as we're creating it, this is one piece of software, one home that all of this content can flow into and allow us to create our content. Which is why I think for screencast for professionals developing courses, if you're going to be developing any volume of courses at all, you want to use the best tools. You don't want to just use the web-based screencasting tools that are kind of allow you to kind of dabble. You want to use the best tools possible, and for that, you're going to be looking at either ScreenFlow or Camtasia. They are the tools that do the job. They assemble all of the different elements. So first of all, I'm very bullish on this aspect. So this is actually a video that we'll come back to in a few moments. But this is the editing portion or the editing file of an actual video that I used in one of my courses. So we'll come back to this in just a few moments. So let me take a step back that now that I've talked about the importance of ScreenFlow of screencasting software. Let's take a step back and let's talk about as we're developing our content for the course. As we're thinking about the course content, you should be constantly in collection mode. If you see an asset, something that you can use in your course, you should be bringing that in and storing it somewhere on your computer, ultimately to get into the course content. And for that, I don't think that there's a better tool on the planet than Evernote. You can use OneNote. There's a few other tools that work very well as well. But to me, Evernote is the tool that works the best. And the reason is often we find this content in our web browser as we're going through. So let's say, imagine I'm going to be doing a course on Snapchat. I don't think I'm actually going to do a course on Snapchat, but imagine I was. So I find this nice little article. So I want to capture this article and store it so that I can retrieve it when I'm actually working on the course content. So I've probably created already a notebook or a file somewhere on my computer that's already collecting different assets for a Snapchat course were I to be creating one. So here I'm just going to use this tool that's installed called the Evernote Web Clipper. It's a free tool that you install with the Evernote and it installs in all the browsers and it launches this little tool that allows us to clip and store the article or anything that we find online. The beauty of it is it will strip out all of the ads, etc., so it makes it much nicer for us to work with. But the real beauty and strength is that it syncs directly with our Evernote account, and you can choose what notebook it's going to go into directly, and you can also choose any tags, which gives you context sensitive search for it later. But once you've found it and you want to save it, you just click save, and now this is an asset that's been added into your Evernote account that when you're ready to start creating your course and you open your Evernote account and you go to that notebook, you will then find all of these assets available to you should you need to use them. To me, this is the most invaluable tool as far as collecting all of my content. The beauty of Evernote is beyond just collecting it on our browser, when you're out in mobile, if you want to take a picture of something, if you find anything, you can store the same content on your phone and it all reflects back in your main account. So this is essential. I look for a couple of collection points of information as I'm building out my course content. First is in broad strokes, I get everything into Evernote. Then once I've got all my assets in Evernote, as I start working in ScreenFlow myself to create the videos, then all of those assets come into ScreenFlow, all of the visual assets come into ScreenFlow, and then anything that's left over, it all kind of gets assembled in Thinkific with the videos that are produced and any extra content that's over. So there's this kind of three-step process. initial research and collection, making of my videos, and then composing it and compiling it all, assembling it all into Thinkific for final delivery. So that's my process as I go through. So let's dive right now back into ScreenFlow, and I recorded a little, I just recorded a little video demo so that I can walk you through the different techniques that I use in all of my videos. Now, this is this isn't really got any educational value. It's just a sample of the type of content that I record. So in this particular case, I've recorded a bit of a screencast, and I've got a my video track running here. So let's start by talking about the most obvious, which is what about keying your video out, Steve? What about the green screen effect? You always have a green screen behind you and you key the video out. Let's talk about the value of that to begin with. Lots of studies have proven that, you know, if your face is on screen, you're more engaging. I don't think we have to convince anybody in this audience that you're more engaging if your face is on screen. Some people have an issue with that because it's more work or they're uncomfortable, or there's a variety of different reasons you may have difficulties with it. And I don't use my face on screen in every single video, but in all the important videos and all the intro videos, and certainly in longer videos, I'll make sure my face appears several times in order to add value. We know that adding your face adds extra comprehension because they understand so much more. So many more senses are brought to bear when they can see the tilt of your head. They can hear the energy of your voice and see the lean and see visually your body language. So those things all help a lot. And it's really up to you whether or not it adds enough value to your course to want to do it. You can do screencasting perfectly well without incorporating your video. You could also not do the green screen effect that I do, which is leaving your video in the bottom corner just in a square, but I like to dress it up a bit, and it's not that hard. You can see that in my green screen here in the background. Let's just zoom in on this a little bit. You can see that the green screen in this particular video isn't all that well stretched out. It's not all that well lit. It's lit okay, but it's not perfect. But it's going to work for us. So here's the process of actually keying out the video from the background. So the first thing you do is in ScreenFlow. If you take a look, you should probably, maybe I should just spend a second here and just give you the key areas of ScreenFlow. We were in the ScreenFlow editing software. I recorded this using my webcam and the screencasting and software itself, which recorded the screen itself and combines the webcam audio and screen feed. This is the canvas here, which is basically the working area. This is what we'll see. It's a very WYSIWYG environment where we see the video here on the screen. Down below are the different tracks. So here is my video track, and there is my background track of my graphics. I can incorporate more elements into it. And these are my tools. This is where I apply different things, different features to the video. Now you notice right away that I'm using screencasting techniques to make this clearer to you. You notice how I zoomed in and zoomed out to draw your eye to the product or to the feature or to the element that I wanted to talk about. This can't be, I can't emphasize strongly enough how much value this simple technique of zooming and pulling in and out, of how much value there is there in adding clarity and adding understanding to a screencast. And I will show you how we do that in just a moment. But first, let's get this darn green screen out of the background here. So how we do that is in ScreenFlow, you choose the video tool. And what I'm going to do is I choose the track itself, which is this video track. We can actually see the audio and video is married together. You can see the little waveform of the video if you cared about what I was talking about, which we're not going to really care about right now. So first thing I'm going to do is turn off the shadow because it automatically adds a drop shadow in the background. It's a little kind of one of the quirks of ScreenFlow. But then I'm going to add a video filter. And the video filter I'm going to add is a chroma key. And when I click add, it looks at the background of the image of the video, decides just kind of through its own intelligence what it thinks should be keyed out, and then it keys it out. And you can see that it's done a good job. It missed the shadow here a little bit because of the color that it chose. It basically chooses a color. So but just by clicking on that color, I can actually say, make sure that you key out that part as well. And now it has keyed out the background quite nicely. Over on the side here, I have a little bit of an overshoot with my video camera just to the edge of my green screen. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to, again, choose the video track. I'm going to choose the cropping tool right here, and I'm just going to slide the left in so that now we can't see it anymore. And there we have now a video that's ready to go. I can zoom in and out using the scale tool. There's also keyboard shortcuts for all of this to be able to position that exactly where I want. And then we're ready to go, and you can see that I'm talking away there. over the top of the screen in the background if I was describing something to you. So that is how easy it is to key something out. Of course, you're not going to want your face quite that large right there, so we can scale it over to the side and we can adjust the size this way. And I'm going to choose the keyboard shortcut actually and just zoom down so you can see I can visually just adjust how it all comes together just by doing that. So there's step one. I've created this, the ability for my face to be on screen, and I think in quite a professional looking way. It looks pretty darn good if you think about it. Well, just if I looked at the camera a little bit, it would be better. So now we've looked at the screen, we've looked at the keying of a video out of the background. Next thing, let us talk about creating clarity in the actual video by doing different camera moves. Well, the first thing that I would do here is, because I've captured my entire screen, is I'd start by zooming in right from the get-go and making the entire background larger, right? So that I don't have, so we don't see all of my mess on my desktop. You don't see my messy bedroom. And I'm going to position the kind of the screen like that so we can just see the screen itself. And actually, I'm going to bring it down a bit because we're going to want to see that. I know we're going to want to see the drop-down menus as the way that I've designed this. So there we go. So there we have the screen ready to go. So as I'm talking along, let's just see what I'm going to actually turn off my video track here because we don't necessarily need to see it all the time. And I can do that just by going into the video track, choosing it, and choosing its opacity and bringing it right down to zero. And so now I've disappeared. I'm still there. It's still synced as far as time. So if I want to bring it in and out, I can do that. And I'll show you how to do that in a moment. But we're going to start with it empty. And we're just going to talk about now how we add clarity to the different camera moves to the screen. So if I let the video run here, I'm just going to let it run. And actually what I'm going to do is I'm also going to go in and I'm going to mute the audio track as well so we don't have where's the volume? There, so I'll just turn the volume down. There we go. So we don't get distracted. So what I've done here is I've scrolled, and now I want to emphasize what's happening right here in this part of the video right here. So as I do that, what I can do is I can choosing the track. I've chosen the background track. You can see it's got a little bit of a marquee around it. What I can do now is in the video moves, I can add what's called an action. When I add an action, anything that I do, we see get a little yellow bar happen right here. What happens is now anything that I do, if I zoom in on the screen, is it will cause that zoom to happen. If I zoom in so that we can just take a look right here at the center of the screen, that's the end point that happens with this little yellow transition. So let's just watch what happens with that we'll just call it a camera move. Zoom. It zooms in on the area that we want. So now we're starting to add some clarity and we're drawing the eye of the viewer, of our student, to the area of the screen that we consider to be important with nothing distracting. So I've done that. So now the next thing that I'm going to do is I know that I'm making a move and I'm probably going up and I'm grabbing I'm going to a menu. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add another action here. And so this is almost like just, if you think about, you know, how a camera moves around on a set or our attention is drawn on a set or in a play from one location to another. This is the blocking. This is the staging. So now we see that what I've done is I'll zoom back out. And now when we go to this menu, I'll stop right there, and we'll take a look at where it goes to right there. It's going to go down to that point there. So I'm going to, at the point of the menu pops down, I'm just going to choose right there. I'm going to add another action. I should have turned off my notifications. I'm going to add another action. And I don't have to do the keyboard shortcut. I can scale in by choosing the scale tool, reposition the canvas in the background. And now our eye is drawn to this point here. And let's just see how that entire sequence. It's just a little short sequence, but you can see how we've added tremendous clarity and value to whatever it is that we're talking about through these simple moves, little camera moves. And they don't take long to do. This is the beauty of it, is as you get comfortable with this tool, I can do the editing of my videos, doing all of these camera moves. It takes very little time. And typically speaking, you're listening to the content and you're basically auditing your content as you go. If you make a mistake, you can do an insert edit. You can trim things out. You can tighten things up a lot, especially if you drop the video, if you don't have a consistent video running with a person talking in the screen, or if you faded them out and before you fade them back up, you can clip little bits out and people won't notice it if you're careful, just like doing audio editing on a podcast. So we've done these sorts of camera moves now. The next thing that we want to talk about is adding different types of assets that you can create yourself, such as annotations. Now, annotations are any graphical elements that we insert. So what I'm going to do at this point here is I want to point an arrow to draw people to say the word local notebook at this point here. So I'm going to click here, I'm going to add plus, and then I draw in the arrow where I want it to go. And what we see now in our timeline is we see the digital asset being inserted. Now it's just going to pop in. I'm going to right click my mouse on that right away and look what I've got here. I've got the ability to add starting and ending transitions. So I'm going to add a starting and ending transition and we'll see them appear here. And what those are is actually there's a whole wide variety of them. Let's see if I can click on the gear. There it is. You can see that we've got all different sorts of transitions that will introduce the element for us. So now we're adding production value at the same time as we're adding clarity. We're making it look more polished and professional. Because if we take a look now at what we just created, is we've zoomed in and now we've got a little arrow going to the notebook where we wanted. And perhaps we wanted at this point here for the arrow to make a move because we made a move. Now this is going to be a little bit clunky, but I can go back to my video actions. I can choose an action and I can take that asset and I can resize it and I can move it down to the area that it's going to go to just as a kind of a little fanciness. But take a look at now what we've done. Boom, 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 goes up and now the arrow moves down to there. There we go. So you've got an idea of bringing in some different extra digital assets, managing them and controlling the attention of your students through this entire process. Now you've noticed that I faded my video in and out several times as we've done this as well, because when, for example, this part here right now, when nothing interesting is happening on the screen, I wanted to bring your eye back to me to keep the engagement going. How do I do that? Well, I'll fade me out now, and I'll show you how we fade me back up here. So let's say at this point here, I want to go back to kind of a more full screen. Let's go to this there. Go action, go zoom that down. And at the same time, just at the same time here, I'm going to choose my video track. I add an action, and then I bring the opacity up. And so what we'll have now is we will have... Oh, I didn't add that as an action, sorry. Let me go there. It was actually down, zero. I didn't click action. Add the action. Now I've got it. And now I bring the opacity up. And so let's see how that looks together. And boom, up comes my face again as the camera move happens again. So you've seen me do this several times as art impersonates life here in this video. And you've seen me do it here on the screen as well. So these small little techniques allow us to basically gain, add a lot of clarity. And I think they also do something else. They also add energy to any screencast because you're obviously going to be passionate or interested or engaged in the content you talk about. So your voice is going to help. Your voice is going to make it that much more enriching and more engaging. But adding your face, if you do decide to go this extra level and add your face and go through these extra production techniques to really polish up your video for your courses, you're just going to create that much better an experience. There are some other benefits. Not only is there more clarity now to your audience as a result of this. Let me just turn this down because this is going to be irritating with my face up here and my face there as well. So I'm just going to get rid of me there. Okay. The other benefit is a much more subtle benefit. But if you look at the long-term life of your online business and the fact that you're selling courses or giving away free courses, often a big part of that is your community is you're going to want to be doing more business with that community over time. And so the more that they like and trust you and know you, the better you off you are. Well, this is a fast track to relationships. Even though it's not a completely conversational relationship, the more they see your face, the more they're comfortable with your voice, the more they get to know you because you are sharing you by being on screen, the more that your community becomes tied to you. You feel closer to... Now, some people might not like how you look and they might leave forever, but it's more people, I believe, are going to be engaged and find this as another reason to support you and to want to be part of your community and your courses moving ahead.
plus just the value you give. You obviously care enough about your content and about them as a student to have gone through steps that are way beyond people who are doing their courses with PowerPoint presentations and none of the editing and effort that goes into screencasting. But I will say this. I don't think this is that much more work than doing presentations the other way. It requires a slightly different thought process, but I don't think it takes that much longer to create videos this way. Now, once we're here, there are so many different assets that we can add to a video, and there's so many different ways that we can go. You've seen the screens moves and that sort of stuff. So let me just jump back into the demo that I'd recorded earlier, which is actually, ironically, this is a video on adding recording assets to screencasting. This is a video from my screencasting course. And what I'm talking about here is adding things like phones, and adding different assets to the screen. So what you see there is actually my iPhone screen. So one of the cool things about using a tool like ScreenFlow on the Mac is if you plug an iPhone in through the Lightning port, if you have one of the newer models of iOS, either you plug in your tablet or your phone, you can then use that as a source within ScreenFlow, and it records. And see this separate track right here? This track right here is actually my iPhone screen. And there's even another technique that we have that we can use where we can record Android screens, let me go ahead, using a tool called Reflector, which will allow us to, there it is, I'm showing you how to set it up right there, and there is my Android screen on camera as well. So you can start to bring other assets, other live assets into your video. So with screencasting software, you have all of the clarity through all of the different camera moves, but you also have the ability to add different assets, graphics, incorporate other video, obviously, but even incorporate other sources such as your smartphones, either Android or iOS. And while we're on this topic, there's even another way that I really like for courses to add extra value. Occasionally, you're going to want to bring an expert in. You're going to want to bring somebody else into the course that adds, you know, it's just another voice, or they're an expert in an area that you maybe aren't as much of an expert in. And in those particular cases, screencasting works exceptionally well because what we do is we record something called a Skype double ender. Using a tool like Call Recorder on the Mac, and there's a variety of tools on Windows. They're escaping me right now, but I'll be typing them into chat, I'm sure, as we're in the middle of this. What you can do is you can record your feed plus your guest's feed in Skype. And then you can split those feeds into two separate video tracks, and then you can incorporate those video tracks into a screencast so that you can have a nice interview show basically built up with you having a conversation with another instructor or an expert on a topic, and then you can create a really nice, simple video that way. I've done this often in my courses. It's a great way to add bonus content or things that you're not really the expert on that you want to incorporate into your content. And for your viewers, it's fantastic. It's like watching a talk show on TV or watching an interview, because you get both, the best of both. You get both faces, and often you'll have even their assets, their digital assets, their website or something else, that you'll have that in the background, and you can move in and out by fading content up or down. You can then again control the theater of that particular presentation. So at the end of the day, screencasting works in so many ways. Let's talk briefly now about efficiency, because I've shown you all of these tools. Obviously, this is a product that is second nature to me. I use the keyboard shortcuts. I don't even think as I manipulate assets. Screencasting software, you will learn to do and you will learn to use once you start and commit to it. You'll be able to master the skills very quickly. There's less things to worry about than there is even in a word processor. There's just a few basic tools, a few basic techniques that you're going to master and you're going to get very quick and efficient at doing. To give you a frame of reference, once you've recorded a video, and it's going to take you a little bit of time to record at the beginning, and probably once we're done here, there'll be lots of questions about the actual presentation side. I wanted to show you the technology side here. We can talk about the presentation side once this pre-recorded element is done. But once I've recorded one of my videos for my YouTube channel, which is pretty much identical to the content that we're delivering in our courses, editing to upload to being complete is only about 45 minutes, maybe 30 minutes to 45 minutes for a video from the time that I finish the recording till it's uploaded and ready for distribution and ready to be optimized in the case of my YouTube videos. So this takes, it's a lot less editing than you do in a text document because you're not spell checking. You might have the odd thing that you have to correct where you go in and you drop in text. I say I misspoke at this point here, or you might even have to record something. But going through and editing and fixing typos and all that sort of stuff and formatting, once you're done, you are done with a video, which is a beautiful, beautiful thing. Once you're finished with the video, what do we do with it? Well, the beauty of these tools is we can publish it directly into almost any video delivery platform that we want. I send mine directly to YouTube. Now, I actually have a YouTube, what I call a back channel in YouTube, where I store all of my video content. I don't even bother if I'm doing a course outside of Thinkific. I don't even bother putting it into a different service. I'll quite often share my content right in YouTube. Of course, if you're using Thinkific, all you do is you export the video as a finished video in whatever quality you want, and then you can upload that asset into Thinkific, and the process is quick and easy. Once you're done with the video, having it now inserted as an asset in the course is pretty much just a 5 minutes of mainly it's just waiting for it to render into the video hosting platform within Thinkific. So that is this pre-recorded element. Let's return, and I'm going to go back to my live video here, and you and I can continue chatting and taking your questions and talking about the entire concept of screencasting for online courses.
And we are back. How about that? lots of good questions, and the chat was really, really active. Thank you, everybody that participated. Whew. I guess we better start answering questions. Do you have anything you want to say first, Greg?
Yeah, just something that came to mind here. You know, two things. One is I know you just covered a ton of stuff, so Steve has a ton of great resources, so keep an eye on him. I'd just say the big thing is just make sure that his emails are actually hitting your inbox. So I know for me, I get a lot of my emails get filtered into other folders, updates, promotions, spam. Just go and search for Dotto in your email, grab it, and make sure you flag it as coming to your primary inbox and have it do that all the time. Just because he has so many great resources, I've made sure to have him come to my primary inbox just so that when he sends me tips on how to do this stuff, I actually get it. So that would be a big thing. And then the other is kind of I was thinking about looking at all of this and thinking, well, why do we do all this stuff? And really, I think one of the biggest things it comes down to is engagement with people who are watching your videos. So whether that's a YouTube video or a course that you're doing all of this stuff keeps people entertained, it keeps them engaged, it adds value around the content that you're creating. And by doing that, that actually leads to people watching the whole video, learning more, finishing your course, getting to the end of the course, which means they're more likely to continue to work with you, more likely to buy your next product or follow you, all of that kind of stuff. So I think important here to keep in mind as well, we're going to talk through a lot of the how, but the why really is, you know, if you do this stuff well, you just get so much better results in terms of even testimonials and reviews and all that kind of stuff.
Thank you. Great points, and I appreciate the shout out. I wasn't going to. This isn't a. We're not here to sell anything, but I do have I'm going to put a link in right now in the chat. This is a link.
I know a lot of people are asking.
This is a link to a mini course that I created on my screencasting process. So this is I think how to create video in less time than writing a blog. And so this is a list builder for me. So Greg's absolutely right. You're going to be getting, I use Infusionsoft, so you're going to be in my email funnel. So you'll be getting some email from me. So if you don't want that, please unsubscribe. But if you do want it, please read it lots and sign up for the things that I offer. But the link that I just put in there, that will bring you into a course. Actually, it's one of the first courses that I developed in Thinkific. But it's how it walks you through the entire process. And it'll repeat and answer a lot of the questions that we've just gone through here with a lot more detail on my hardware and software setup and that sort of stuff, and then I take you through my entire editing process. So please jump on board. It's a free course, and sign up for that. But now what we should do is I should jump in, and I'm going to go across, and I'm just going to work my way through the questions, and I see a lot of them. I'm going to start at the bottom and work my way up. So while you, if you have more questions, continue to put them in. If you just click on the little the speech bubble on the side of the chat, it converts it into a question, so it demarks it as a question, so I don't look at it as the conversation that's going along the side. And Jen's also going through and cherry-picking out all of the questions to make sure that we get them. So N asked, N, I wonder if N is related to Q. I have a gravelly voice, Steve. it's some video, some people don't like it. How can I overcome this issue? I don't know. You know, our gifts, our presentation gifts, our voice, our face, that's kind of what it is. If it's that irritating, you know, you might play with different mic locations so that you can kind of move it a little bit farther away, but I don't really have a good solution for you. Sorry about that. Yeah, Abram's asking what my pro setup is. My pro setup, as far as my audio setup, I use an Electro Voice RE20 microphone, which is also called the Stevie Wonder mic. It's one of the most popular voiceover mics from radio studios, and my old radio studio that I used to do the show converted to headsets, and I scooped this up for a bargain. And then it has to go through a little bit of a preamp because it's the gain is a little low on this, and then it goes into an AD conversion box, which is also a mixer. So we have to convert the analog signal from this to digital. If you get a USB mic like the we're talking about the Yetis and stuff, you don't have to worry about this entire audio setup. But my setup is, again, in that little mini course, I walk through in detail the pieces of it. But for me, audio is number one. I really, really need to have good quality audio. You can also tell, I mean, I've got a bit of a radio voice. I did radio shows for over a decade. So my ear is very sensitive. And I hate it when I listen to poor quality audio coming in a screencast because I know that it's so easy for us to do better. So just stepping up that game adds such an impression of quality to your screencast. You know, if you hear hollow audio when you're watching somebody else's course, somewhere in the back of your mind you're asking how much effort they really put in, even if it doesn't come to the fore of your mind. This creates a real permanence, a real quality by having good quality audio. So I can't encourage you strongly enough to do that. Sunny asks, what do I think of the quality of the iPhone 6S to record video? Oh, our smartphones for recording video in a variety of different ways are absolutely brilliant. If you're not doing full-on screencasting where you're sitting down in front and recording the screen, but you're actually capturing video, the quality of your smartphones is spectacular. Look at adding a lav or a better quality microphone. So even using the headset is better than nothing. But trying up the quality of the audio, but as far as video quality goes, you know, for what we're doing, it's as good as it gets. Neville asks about my recommendations for lighting. Yes, I've got a little cheat sheet of all of my gear, which I'll include in a follow-up email. I'll have to write it. I don't have it written yet, but I've got all of the parts all broken out. I just use lighting from a company called Cowboy Lighting Studios, and you can buy them on Amazon. A couple hundred dollars. I use little umbrella lights. The key to the lights is their daylight. Their 5500 Kelvin is the color of the light, which is natural daylight, which means that your skin looks a more natural tone. A lot of people have commented, and we'll find the questions, about the reflection on my glasses. I don't wear the same glasses doing this as I do out and about. Here's my glasses I wear on the street. And there's probably a little bit of reflection here. Now, there's a couple of reasons. These ones have a blue tint in them to make them a little bit more comfortable when I'm out and about. But they're also, all the different variable focus points, bifocal, trifocal, progressive lenses. That's it. Thanks a lot. And my eyesight is not getting any better. I'm getting older. These glasses have a very high index lens, meaning a very thin lens. They're Nikon lenses. And they're also called task glasses. They only have one level of focus, and it's designed to focus on the distance that my screen is away, so it makes it easier for me to work. So they serve two purposes. They allow me to work more comfortably on my computer screen, visually myself, but they also are very small. You see, they're even smaller than the other ones, and they don't catch the reflection. Beyond that, you just have to work at setting your lights up so that you don't catch the reflection. So those are the things for as far as for setting up my glasses. Next question is, how do you have the screen with the screen in the background? Oh, Ken asked. Well, that's basically, I realized that I didn't mention to you just one of the kind of the basic philosophies of screencasting. You know, in the old, maybe I did, I can't remember in the video now, but in the old days, you would record your video and you'd have all these assets from video, and then you'd have all your graphic assets and your audio assets, and then you'd come together in an editing studio and do it and put it all together and build it into a final product. Screencasting covers all of that. It covers the capture of all of your content. You bring all of your assets in and you just import them as graphics or as audio tracks or as video tracks, and then you assemble them all right within the screencasting software. And both Camtasia and ScreenFlow do this brilliantly. And it just streamlines and speeds up the process so much. Regular video editing software doesn't do the things that screencasting software does. Those camera moves of the screen zooming in and out and the screen and the canvas behind sliding around, those are designed for screencast. If you want, a lot of people use mouse pointer, mouse pointer effects, where you can actually make your mouse pointer seem larger. And every time you click a mouse, little radial buttons spring out from it. Or everything around your mouse cursor, a circle around your mouse cursor, dims, and just the center of the cursor is lit up. That's the sort of stuff that screencasting software brings when you're illustrating what's happening on screen. All of our courses, though, aren't on screen. So how does screencasting software fit in that particular case? Well, even if you're importing video, the fact that you can edit it so quickly in the multi-track editor and you're comfortable with it makes it a valuable asset. I don't edit. I have Final Cut Pro. I haven't launched it in 2 years because I don't need it. Everything that I need for my video, I can do in ScreenFlow. It's that good, a simple, basic video editor. Okay, so we've talked my green screen setup a little bit. What's the camera like plug-in called? I think I was talking about the fact that we're doing white balancing on the camera, and in the Mac it's called webcam settings. And if you're in the Windows, just the drivers for the Logitech will do it for you. Ross asks, how I remove the green color with clean lines. And apparently some people that use Camtasia have indicated that they've got a little bit of a halo effect around them as they're doing it. Well, in ScreenFlow, you saw in the little demo I did that you can use a color picker to select the color from the background to make sure you're picking the correct color for the closest match color for the green screen effect to key out. And what I do is I find the darkest. If you look at the screen behind me right now, there's probably some, you can see some kind of darker shadowy areas. Those will be harder to key out, or they won't key out because the lighter areas will key first. So I select that area and then it keys kind of all that area within a range. It comes down to how clean your lights are, how well the background is lit, and how much separation you can create with what you're wearing, and how close the colors of anything you're wearing are to the background. But I find that in ScreenFlow, it's very forgiving. I don't know if Camtasia is as forgiving, but I've never had an issue. The biggest issue I have is as I'm growing my beard, I get a little fuzzy beard, and sometimes if I'm not careful, this little fuzz will kind of carry a halo with it. And so you might have noticed at the beginning of the video that I just showed you, I chose a green fixed background, a green computer-generated background, just to kind of mitigate that and to make it look a little bit better. So just a little technique thing that happened there. Okay, so next question here. We got lots of them. Steve, how long does it take a pro like me to develop a single screencast video for YouTube from start to finish? I'm not going to talk about the amount of time that it takes me to decide on my content, because that's up in the air. You know, sometimes it takes me a long time to come up with a narrative that's the story. But from the time that I sit down in front of the camera till the time that I have that video uploaded to YouTube and ready for Jen to start applying all of our different SEO and optimization is anywhere from a short time of an hour and a half to a long time of 2.5 hours. And if it's 2.5 hours, it means I've had to re-record it a couple times because I've had issues. It takes me longer to record, to do the actual recording, because I tend to do it in one chunk. Because I like the feel of that seamless shot. And for me, the toughest part is the tops and tails. So actually, I teach in my screencasting course some techniques that really help. For example, I use a format. I talk about how strong format is as far as being a tool for creating repeating content like I do for my YouTube channel. If you watch any of my videos, you'll see I have a definite format. That saves me so much time because I'm not making artistic decisions all the way through. I know exactly where I am in my video at any point, and I know what I need to say next, and I know what's coming up next. So it removes a lot of the challenge and a lot of the burden, especially since I usually fly solo without a script. I usually don't use a script. I just have point form of what I want to cover. So I can legitimately do between an hour and a half and 2.5 hours, I can have a 7 to 12 minute video published. For course content, it can be even less, because I'm not as worried about all of the different, I'm not worried about making that video as fancy, but it takes me longer to prepare the content for that video. It takes me longer, more work beforehand, which is going to be the same, I think, regardless, because we have to know our content before I get it ready to go. So I hope that that answered that question. How do you like the green screen, distance from the screen? Okay, that's all covered, I said, in the other video, so we won't talk any more about green screen. We've covered the replay. It's coming very shortly. Nicola asks, I'm presuming Camtasia and PC doesn't do the adding the phone thing. Camtasia does, and it uses a tool. It's actually a series of tools from people called Air Parrot, I think, and I use the tool called Reflector 2 on the Mac in order to bring an Android screen onto my Mac screen, and they've got tools that will allow you to bring the phone screens into the Camtasia world. So check them out. We'll include a link as well to that. Actually, Jen, can you make a note so that I get that link in? Does ScreenFlow work on top of iMovie or completely a separate editor? It's a separate editor, but you can import movies that you've edited somewhere else as a part of the screen, or you can take your ScreenFlow movies and export them and bring them into iMovie and then continue to work with them. So it works in the same file formats. It's just in the output format. It's MP4 or QuickTime files. It's not going to you can't work on each other's editing files. That's where the difference is. Is there a lav mic that's a good one to free me up from the microphone? Yeah, there are plenty of good lav mics. A lot of people use them. I don't worry too much about them, but I'm pretty sure a quick Google search, or something like B&H Photo would probably have some good recommendations in that area, or even Amazon would have a good recommendation. I can't recommend one because I've bought a few and I've used them occasionally, but I haven't really tested them all out. How can we contact Steve? info@dottotech.com. Jen, can you put that in? You can reach out to me at any time. How do I export in high quality? When you do an export of from either Camtasia or ScreenFlow, you can select the quality of video that you're going to export. So that's not a problem at all. Anthony asks, I'm still confused concerning OS support. Is there a native Windows 10 version of the app, or does it... I'm not too sure exactly where Camtasia sits right now. You'd have to check the Camtasia site. I believe it should be running native in OS 10 and in Windows 10, but I'm not 100% secure on that. ScreenFlow, of course, is iOS only, or is OS X, is Mac only. Lyles, had some issues with ScreenFlow uploading to YouTube where it drops the 4K resolution or loses an element. Any suggestions? Oh, go to the ScreenFlow users forum, Lyle. I actually never uploaded in 4K, so you're ahead of me as far as that goes, and I'll look forward to hearing back from you how it's working. But just go to the ScreenFlow users forum. They're very responsive there. How do you edit iMovie first and then move it to ScreenFlow? Or is everything done in ScreenFlow? I don't use iMovie first, but if you did, you would edit your movie in iMovie, export it as a QuickTime file, and then just import that entire QuickTime file. So you wouldn't be able to edit discrete elements as you had in iMovie. You'd have it as a video asset at that point. Nancy says, please answer my question. I'm a beginner in Camtasia and can do talking heads and green screen and closed captioning. How do I use them all together? You're up on a mountain in Turkey. Okay. Well, Nancy, the way that you use them all together is basically you just layer it as you're doing the work. You said, so as you record your video, you're capturing both the video and the screen. So you've got that video for your either green screen or the key, or to have a little video box in the bottom. Once you've finished and completed your video, the closed captioning, I don't embed closed captioning in the video at that point. I don't know if there is a way to do it, although I do think that you can, you could create a text track. I don't know if it's actual closed captioning in Camtasia. It might be. It's not in ScreenFlow. But once I've uploaded it to YouTube, that's where I do all of my closed captioning. So the closed captioning happens post uploading the video. Now, YouTube will automatically do a rough version of voice recognition closed captioning, but we actually take each one of our videos and we have a person that writes a transcript, and then we take that transcript, and it takes a couple of weeks for this all to resolve, but we take that transcript then, and then Jen uploads that and then attaches it to the video in YouTube. So that's how we incorporate the closed captioning. So it's post-production. Android phone support, video support, okay, too. Any better? And better than computer. Android, yeah, if you're recording the video on an Android phone and you're exporting the video, it's phenomenal as well, absolutely. Ross says, I noticed you do not remove your breaths. I edit using headphones and hear every breath and try to silence them. Yeah, I don't. My mic's pretty good. I don't know, does it sound like I'm breathing very heavily? I don't. No, it's never bothered me. If I notice if I cough or something, I'll sometimes tighten that up and edit it out. But this isn't for broadcast. It's for broadcast, but it's not like the type of video. When we did our TV show, we had 22 minutes and 30 seconds of content that we could put forward, and we were jealous of every second. And if I stumbled slightly in any word, we would reshoot and re-edit. YouTube is far more, it's just a little looser as far as the quality goes. And I think people appreciate the fact that you are human and they see you stumble a little bit or stutter a little bit. So whereas that was never acceptable for me when I was doing a syndicated TV show, it's all fine now. If I sneeze all over or if I choke or something like that, I'll clean that up and edit it up. But for the little things, for me, it's not worth tidying it up. And I know people that do that in their podcasts, is they take out every and they make themselves sound ever so intelligent. And then when they meet people in real life, they realize that they're nowhere near as well-spoken as they appeared to be in their podcast. How many Skype conversations are broken into two, can be broken out in streams? I've done three at a time. I believe I've done three once, yes, but I know you can do two. We're talking about the double-ended Skype where you record a Skype conversation and then you split it out. I haven't checked how many streams, but actually, again, Jen, if you make a note of that, I'll try and answer that and I'll get back to you, Marcelo, on that.
You're right there about the just, you know, editing out breaths and all that kind of stuff. I think that's a really good point of you know, going too far towards perfection. I think, you have a format, you have a system that you actually teach people of how to, you know, like, this is my format, this is how I produce a video, and it's great to have a system. And I think part of that is deciding how far towards perfection you want to go. Because if you say, okay, I've got an hour to edit a video, or I want to get videos done in 2 hours, give yourself that time limit, create a format that works in the time limit, and then, you know, don't worry about being perfect, because the reality is it'll never be perfect, and if you try and go for editing out every single breath and making every green screen absolutely perfect, you're going to end up with a lot less videos or even no videos.
Yeah. Yeah, you can definitely be paralyzed by perfection, absolutely. And I'm just noticing the time. We're at 11:06. Now, I like to try and keep these webinars to an hour. There's still questions. I'm not going to abandon you, but anybody who has to leave now, I want to thank you all very much and thank Greg for hosting this webinar. If you do have to leave, the replay will have all of the additional content in it, so you can catch up as well. And I'll be sending out an email to you, which will have all of the additional resources as well as a reminder of the replay link. So anybody who has to leave right now, I have to thank you all very much and give some real props to Greg and the folks at Thinkific for putting this together for us. And then let's dive back in and get through the rest of these questions. Good.
And then the note there for everyone, just make sure that you've got check your email for Dotto. Make sure that you're getting those emails from him because he's going to send out the replay and other resources, and you want to make sure that you're getting access to all that stuff. And yeah, we will stick around and keep answering a few questions here, but thanks so much, Steve. I really appreciate this. This was awesome. I think it'll be really helpful for a lot of people, and already seeing that in all the comments, people saying this is awesome. so that's great. Thanks.
Good. Well, that's good to hear. Yeah, we don't like to disappoint. Okay, any tips on handling background shadows? Yeah, do a good job lighting in the foreground. The more lights that you have to throw at the problem, the better as far as dealing with background shadows. So I just use a three lighting situation. I have kind of a big key light up top and then two umbrella lights that are balancing off. I don't go for fancy. I go for making sure my face is well lit, and that's pretty much what I worry about. John says, what do I think about using full screen taking to full screen talking to camera switching between with full screen of a screencast? Oh, so I think what John's saying is having a full screen video and then doing a switch the way they made in television to a full screen screen of the computer. I have no issues with that at all. Very easy to produce that way if you choose to, as opposed to having your face keyed over the content. I think it would work just fine. And if that's your technique, that's your technique. It's going to work just great. Philip asks, how well does the software you have discussed for Mac work with the educational software Moodle? It's going to work just fine as far as Moodle. Moodle is a course delivery system similar to what we're doing in Thinkific, or you're doing pretty much in a variety of different tools. We're not talking about the delivery platform. We're talking about the content that goes into that platform, so all of the software works just fine for that. Philip says, I teach horticulture. If I recorded video of me doing a gardening technique outside, is it easy to edit that and add it to a screencast? Yes, it would be. And the nice thing, what you could do is you could shoot it as B-roll. So you just do that. If you want to have your voiceover and be explaining things as you're going, then make sure you've got good audio. You've got maybe a lav mic attached so that you can record it properly. But then when you bring it in afterwards, if you want to record a voiceover track, you can actually just watch the video, record the voiceover, marry that together, and that's going to help you produce your course content. So it would work just fine that way. There's several questions about the Logitech C920 I see here. Paul and Nikki have asked questions, asking is the C920? Oh, it's gone. You can't take them out before I've read them. Jen, geez, is the C920 better than the C930 set up for PC, and how do you adjust it? I don't know if the C920 is better than the C930 because I don't have a C930, but the C920 is cheaper, and it does high-def video, and it seems to work just fine as far as this goes. I keep looking for something that'll do a better job on video, and the reviews, nobody's come up with one that seems to be better than the Logitech C920. I think the C930 is it give you a slightly different aspect ratio opportunity.
I'm not positive. I think the C930 is more, it's a bit more set up for things like Skype and has some other things in it, but I think the C920 actually, for what you're doing, it produces better results.
Good, thank you.
Recording videos and courses, you've got a better setup, and it's just more standard in its setup, so I think you're better off with the 920.
Absolutely, okay.
And Steve, sorry, I erased Paul before you could ask that. I got a little click happy over here.
Yeah, I have one job, and I'm going to do it fast.
Yes, I'm very efficient. So he has the Logitech C920. He said it's set up for PCs, and how do you adjust it for a Mac?
When you plug it in on the Mac, there's no drivers for the Mac. It'll automatically work on the Mac. If you want to adjust the color and do that color correction, it's a tool called webcam settings, which is available at the Mac store, at the Apple store. It's about $8. In Canadian dollars, it's like 30, but about $7 or $8 US, and that gives us control over the white balance and color and focus and all those sorts of things of the camera. Okay, Gary asks, like Joy, I use Screencast-O-Matic a bit. They have a method to clear, or do they have a method for to clear or transparent green screen? I don't know, Gary. I'm sorry. That's one that I haven't used Screencast-O-Matic enough. For me, those introductory products or those web-based products are fine to dabble, or for a school teacher that wants to like do a single screencast and isn't going to turn it into a profession. If you're creating courses, I think it behooves you to use the tools that are best for your courses, especially if you're charging for your courses. And I don't believe that any web-based tool is going to do as well as either Camtasia or ScreenFlow as far as that goes. So, and ScreenFlow is $97 US. It's not a huge investment. Michael asks, what would be a reasonable cost to pay someone on Upwork to have someone annotate an existing screencast with some standard Zoom editing type effects? You got me. I don't know. I don't know. I wish I did. If anybody has hired anybody to do this kind of stuff, I mean, I find it, for me, it doesn't take me that much time, and it's the core of my business. My YouTube channel is the core of my business, so I want it done right and done the way that that I like, so I just do it myself. I would imagine the $30 to $40 an hour range, you can probably get somebody that's going to probably do some fairly good work for you, but I would just take a look and see what the market bears there. And maybe somebody else here has a recommendation, or they've hired somebody to do that kind of stuff.
I've done some through Craigslist. I mean, we're lucky in Vancouver because we have a lot of film schools here and a lot of film grads and a budding film, well, a huge film industry. So, but I found people even in the $20, $25 range or sometimes less. Now, often you get what you pay for, but people coming straight out of film school who fully have the ability to do this kind of stuff, nice thing about that is I can sit down and work with them in person. The biggest thing for any of the film stuff, if you're going to pay someone to do it, is just make sure you really go through their demo reel and get a good idea. Get them to show you the kind of stuff that they've done which matches with what you want and that you like what they've delivered. And then give them a mini sample project. Don't dive into some massive project with them. Give them a sample project and make sure you're happy with that.
Excellent. Nancy asks how to create a layered style video showing the background video and a person in front and that person has a transparent background around them. Can that be completed using ScreenFlow or Camtasia? It can, as long as you have some sort of a way to key the person out of the background, like green screen behind them. So if you're recording them separately in video, you may have to make sure that they're in a background that you can key out, unless you want to have it in a box where you can actually see their background. But you have to have some sort of a background that you can apply that alpha channel to make it transparent. Philip says, how do you protect your video from being copied and recorded and then passed on for free? I don't worry about it. I keep running. I keep making new video. If somebody within a tool like Thinkific, there's built-in protection, you know, as far as the membership side. If only people who should have access to it do have access. If somebody's going to steal my video, I'm not too worried about it. How are they going to make it their own, and how are they not going to help promote my brand ultimately? So I don't spend too much time worried about that. Melissa asks, a newbie here, she says, can you repeat why you would use a video within this webinar rather than a screenshot and how? Okay. The reason that I pre-recorded the video and used the screencast in this particular webinar is if I was to just do that demo live first, it would be much more difficult for me to stay on task, stay on point, stay on focus doing it live. So it could have taken longer. I can tighten it up in a screencast, which allows me to respect your time. So I did tighten that up a little bit. I cut out some fluffy areas that I didn't explain things well, etc. So that is number one. Number two is bandwidth issues. If we had an issue with bandwidth upload or download, or you're having issues download, live streaming video has to be encoded on the fly, and it takes up a lot more space, so the resolution is much lower. This video was recorded, it was compressed into an MP4 format, it was uploaded to YouTube, and it was streamed from YouTube, which is going to stream through in very high quality. So you had great clarity, and you had much higher quality video than you're even getting right now from me. And I can't set up to do the screen moves to draw your eye to do the teaching that I was able to do in the video as well. So all of those reasons combined is why I use screencasts within my webinars. And then it allows me also to jump into chat and get a lot better feel for the questions and the energy of the audience and to add more value by answering questions, which I think ends up respecting your time even that much more. So that's why I did it that way. Raylene asks, what is Snagit? Snagit is a screen capture tool that comes from the people at TechSmith. So on the Mac side, it's sort of like Evernote Sketch. I think Snagit might actually capture little video clips too. I'm not positive, but it basically allows you to do screen captures, capture an area of a screen or a whole screen itself that you can then use as a digital asset. Melissa says, thanks, Greg, because it will show with more clarity on the screenshot. Do you know how to add video in Google Hangouts and cut to it during the webinar? Oh, so
he was just asking how you're doing what you're doing, but it's mostly with Webinar Jam, right?
Where you Webinar Jam is what does that. Yeah, so I use Webinar Jam as a wrapper that sits on top of Google Hangouts, and we can preload video assets into Webinar Jam, which is how we did that. Yeah. Do you know if an iRig HD mic is combined with a Galaxy 10 tablet, that sounds pretty good. Yeah. Is compatible with the, I don't know if it's compatible though. If it is, it sounds like it would be a good solution, Nancy. Beth asks, is there a way for me to have an app for your business so people can open the app and go right to your course? I don't know. Greg would be a better one to answer that. But that's sort of what Thinkific does. If you stop and think about it, it's just basically, it's a link that they go to that brings them into the course module. So
yeah, it's not a mobile app, but it is mobily responsive, so people can load it right on their phone. But if you're looking specifically for a mobile app, that would be something that you could custom build. But yeah, so you can give people a link that they can open right on their phone as mobily responsive, but it's not a mobile app per se that would be in the App Store.
So Steve asks, if can you use a chroma key green screen effect in a live stream? Is it resource intensive? Yes, it would be. And is it recommended for recorded video edit only? I would never try it just because of the resources, and I wouldn't necessarily know what, you know, the value that it would bring versus the challenges that it would bring at this point. Make it something that I wouldn't do. There are some ways I think you can do it using tools like Open Broadcast Studio or Livewire, but it would be very resource intensive and kind of nerve-wracking.
Yeah, it's a whole other set of tools, hardware, everything, and so I would master what Steve's teaching first, get that down, and then if you want to start getting into the live broadcasting green scheme, that's actually like a whole other level of and where you're probably getting to having other people on set as well.
Okay, Melissa's asking, she's used XSplit for live screencasting. What would I say about the main differences? I've never used it, so I can't really comment on it, and I can't say whether or not I would use it in place of ScreenFlow or Camtasia. But I'm telling you, for screencasting, those two tools, you know, the gap between everything else that I've seen in those two tools is profound. Nikki's asking what the app is called for using the C920 on the Mac. It's called Webcam Settings. That'll be in the email that we send out. So Melissa says, love that. Totally now get it. Woo, good. Woo, actually, woohoo. Last question. Would background be added in ScreenFlow or Camtasia as an asset or in Zone Track? It's added as it's brought in as a digital asset into the bin, and then it's applied to its own track. So I bring that background in, and then I drop it down as a track. And then if it's a graphic, you can just stretch out how long it stays on screen and then make sure that it's the one that's immediately, it's layered. It's just, you know, foreground to background layering. Okay. Avram asks, why I chose Webinar Jam? I chose Webinar Jam because when I started doing webinars, it was offered a lifetime license for a very good price, and it did the job as well as any does it within Google Hangouts, and the other options are very expensive and somewhat limiting as far as your replay goes. Here's the thing about webinar software. I don't recommend any of them. I actually have a Webinar Jam affiliate link, and I do make a little bit of money from Webinar Jam, and I use Webinar Jam, but Webinar Jam scared the pants off me about 15 minutes before our webinar started today because it was having some real issues. They just got their act together moments before, and so we could have had a crash and burn today, as you can with any webinar technology. I know that Greg, do you mind me sharing a little bit of that story? Greg, you use Zoom, which is a great tool, and it cacked on a big webinar they were doing last week, and then they sent out an email to all of the people saying it was Greg's fault, or making it sound as it was Greg's fault. And Zoom is a great company.
It was the notice when they tried to log in, but yeah, it was. Yeah. Generally, I find Zoom has been really, really good.
Yeah, and there are really good ones. There are some ones that I'm keeping a really close eye on that I think are doing an exceptional job coming down the pipe. But none of them have my recommendation. I use Webinar Jam because it works for me. I make money from it. I'm a technical guy, and I've mastered the challenges of it, and I think the technique that I use to deliver my webinars overcomes many of the limitations of it, and I've developed techniques like adding the screencast to overcome those limitations. I do like its integration. Nothing to do with what happens on air. I like its integration with my CRM, with Infusionsoft, and how I can do that API level integration of managing my communications with people who subscribe to my newsletter or subscribe to my webinars and that sort of stuff. So there are some benefits to it, but I would be loath to recommend it. I don't like the philosophy of the company. I don't like how they have a product called Evergreen Webinar or Ever Webinar, which is related to Webinar Jam, which allows you to put on a webinar that looks as though it's live and is actually pre-recorded and basically fools people. I hate the concept of these faux webinars. I rail against them. So, having said that, if you do decide to buy it, please use my affiliate link. I don't consider it a recommendation because I don't actually believe it's that much better than any other product out there right now. And I wish I did. I've been looking and trying to find one that I could really solidly recommend, but they all have warts. Okay. Well, I got editorial. Yvette, newbie here. I didn't hear how you created the opt-in page for your free course. Is that a part of Thinkific? The one that you went to for this, I probably created it myself on my own site, and then I used the Thinkific. Thinkific has a tool to allow us to create an opt-in link or to create a registration link that brings it in. That's probably the way we did it because again, one of the things I like about Thinkific is how it integrates with Infusionsoft. I can't recall exactly how I set that one up, but if it's really important to you, send me a note at info@dottotech.com, and I'll walk you through the process. I'll show you how we set up our opt-in page. Elena asks, hi there, I'm new to screencasting. Thank you for the information. Just to clarify, the recorded bit you did, did you do the video of yourself separately and then add the computer screen? Sorry if it's a it's not a silly question in any way, sure, or it hasn't been covered. When I recorded the recorded bit that you saw today, I did that all in one take. I just sat down in front, started the recording, took two starts at it, and then recorded it. But the screens happen in real time. So as I was talking and looking at the screens and kind of narrating it, that was all synced and happening in real time. There was a few assets that I dropped in, like the pictures of Sue Zimmerman and I when we were talking about the Skype double ender. Those were assets that I grabbed in screenshots from other videos and dropped in, but that was all done in one thing. That's the beauty of screencasting, is what you're showing on screen is if you're navigating from slide to slide or web page to web page or moving around on your screen, that's all synced with your dialogue in real time. That's a big strength of screencasting. Can I recommend a portable microphone? That is the brand you mentioned in Thinkific or something like that. A portable microphone, if it's just straight audio recording, something like the Zoom the Zoom H4N field recorder for just straight recording audio. As far as ones that are going to plug in to a phone, like a lav mic or something like that, I don't really have a recommendation. Just take a look on Amazon. They're going to be about like $35 for a little lav mic, and there's a variety of them out there, and I don't know which one is best. Is there a minimum distance you should maintain from the camera lens? Whatever your framing is. You know, and whatever your lighting setup is. I've got mine set on the bezel of my computer monitor. I used to use a video camera and try different things, and it would actually have a tripod behind and have a higher quality video camera. It's just whatever works best for you as far as framing and the zoom potential of that particular camera. Can I recommend an affordable handheld and mountable video recorder? Well, you can't go wrong with the GoPros. Yeah, they're awesome. I don't know. I haven't used them myself because I'm not that athletic, but everything I see coming from them looks phenomenal. David, this could be our last question. Is the screencasting course for non-techies, i.e. step-by-step? Yes, so my screencasting course is for non-techies, i.e. step-by-step. We will be refreshing it and adding some extra content to it for a re-release coming, hopefully in the middle of October is when we're going to be re-releasing our screencasting course. It is my flagship course. It's the one that I'm kind of most proud of all of my courses. And you all will hear about it as we kind of get closer to the next revision of it. One thing I will tell you, if any of you are interested in it and you want to dive in right now, but you want to get the new content, is with all of the Dottotech courses, if you sign up for one of my courses, when I re-release that course and revision it and bring out new content in it, everybody who's ever bought it in the past gets access to all of the new content. So you buy one of my courses once, and then you get that course through the life cycle of the course. So awesome. That's it.
That's thanks, Steve. That's really good. And so I know we covered a lot of stuff, and you know, you went through how to do this, and people have tons of questions about how to do these specific things. Steve's a great resource for that. If you check out his screencasting course, then you'll get a ton of information about actually walking you through all of the steps on how to do all of this stuff. So if you really are looking to implement that, you'll save, you know, I know going through it myself saved a ton of time in doing these kind of things, so it'll save you a ton of time in getting everything set up and frustration and just making sure you have all the right tools. I've literally spent months testing systems like this to get to a place where I'm happy with it, and then, you know, gone and watched what Steve's doing and said, okay, I'm just going to do what he's doing. That's just so much easier than trying to figure it all out for myself.
That's good. I just dropped the link in again for the free course that we've got, which basically teaches you a lot. You know, go through that. That might be enough to get you going. And if you like the style that you see there and you're comfortable with that, then that's going to be more of what you're going to get if you sign up for any one of my other main courses. Is screencasting for PC? Absolutely, using Camtasia. Camtasia would be the tool that you would use. And with that, I think it's about time that we wrap things up. Thanks, Meredith, for endorsing the course. I appreciate that. Greg, your community, as I expected, was awesome. It was a real pleasure and an honor to be able to share with them, and I hope that they got some new ideas, and it really helps them in their journey for creating their courses. There's a lot of pride. One of the things about using, setting up a course is, when you start bringing those assets in place and then you go to that student view of the course as you're building it out in Thinkific, and you see what people come to, and you see how much work you've put in place, and you see how much value you've put in place, it's a great feeling. I really like it, and it's very empowering. So I'm glad to be a small part of that in your community's life and experience. So, do you have anything to say, or should I just wrap it up?
That's great. Just want to say thank you for coming. Thank you for sharing all that awesome advice. I think even just the comments alone here, we're already seeing that people are super excited about everything you shared. So thanks so much. And also, yeah, for everyone who's looking for more advice on this going forward, I think we just touched on things here, and Steve's got a ton of great advice for you. So make sure you check him out and make sure you're getting his emails.
Good. Oh, Troy asked me if I have any input with the Camtasia people getting put their price down. No, they wouldn't. They don't listen. No. Folks, thanks so much. Jen, I know we haven't let you talk much other than me yelling at you the odd time, but thanks a lot for supporting and monitoring the channel. I appreciate you as always. Jen is the mastermind behind all of our videos that goes up. She massages all of our videos on YouTube and does all of our blog posts, so she's an important part of the Dotto Tech team, so thanks so much. Greg, it was a pleasure. Thanks to you guys at Thinkific. Keep up the good work. And for everybody else, the replay will be on its way. Reach out to me, the info at Dotto Tech. You can just reply or post comments and questions at my YouTube site, at my channel on YouTube. That's where I respond the most as far as social networking goes. So that's it. We're going to wrap things up. Till next time, thanks to everybody that joined in. I'm Stu Dotto. Have fun storming a castle.